thoughts and said at funeral services when I preached them, that can you imagine me standing on heaven's shore and seeing somebody finally get home? I just wonder sometimes what that sight is all about. You know, the Bible says, ear has not heard, eye has not seen, nor has it entered into the heart of man what's waiting. When you just think about that, whenever we finally see heaven and see what it is, see the truth and the reality of heaven. I want to remind you tomorrow night, Monday through Wednesday night, the revival meeting will start at 7 o'clock. And on Wednesday night, if we can, and if you will, I want to, be with us at 5:30, and we're going to have a meal here at the church. So Brother Kenneth, he's going to be cooking us some barbecue, and so just ask you to bring something to go with that, and we're going to eat at 5:30. And so come be with us and enjoy, and pray for the revival meeting each night, 7 o'clock. And had a wonderful meeting this morning, and so we're anticipating a good message from the Lord again tonight. And I do want to also tell you that next Sunday will be our homecoming here at the church, and Brother Derek Millines will be preaching for us on Sunday morning. And then we'll have lunch following the morning service this coming Sunday. Be much in prayer tonight. Brother David Arnold, he's had a rotary cuff surgery. One prayer for Brother Hobbs, and also April's father, Brother Tom. Let's remember in prayer tonight. And also Brother Charlie Grimes, Brother Bert and Sister Francis, continue to remember in our prayers tonight. Brother Ralph and Miss Jane tonight, and also Miss Velma Bentley and Brother David Whittlebury and Ronnie tonight. And we have several unspoken requests tonight that we want to be mindful of, and I'm glad to know that the Lord is mindful of us, and so I want to be much in prayer for that tonight. And before we pray tonight, is there anyone else that may have a request before we go before the throne tonight? Anybody? All right. Do pray for the revival, and pray for Brother Tony and Miss Kayla as they're with us this week, and travel mercies on them to go back to West Virginia. And it's good that we can be in the house of the Lord. It's been a long time since I've been on church on Sunday nights, but familiar ground to me. And so let's bow our hearts and just open the service tonight with a word of prayer, and remember those tonight that needs a touch, and I pray the Lord's blessings on the service. Brother Kenneth, Bishop, could I get you to ask the blessing over the service tonight for me, please, brother?
Most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you tonight,
yes, Lord,
for the privilege and the honor to be able to come into your house and worship you and praise you, Lord.
Be real.
Father, we pray that your Holy Spirit,
yes,
Lord Jesus, will clear our minds, Lord, and prepare our hearts for the message that you've given Brother Tony tonight, Lord. Yeah, Father, we've got sick amongst us,
yes,
and we've got
Lord.
People suffering from depression,
yes,
Lord, and people that just really need a touch from
yes,
you tonight, Lord, but you're our healer, our restorer,
yes, Lord.
And Father God, you're our Savior. If we've got any here tonight, Lord, that don't know you, we pray, dear God, that something will be said and done tonight to touch their heart,
yes,
Lord,
yes.
And they'll make a commitment to serve you. And we give you the praise and the honor and the glory in Jesus' name.
Amen. 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 All right.
Page 345.
Thank you. Gallery. And
Anybody got any strife going on tonight? Amen. It's going to be worth heaven. Amen. Brother Vince, I do believe that heaven is going to be worth it all tonight. And if not, I don't believe I could go another mile if I didn't think that heaven was real tonight. And heaven was real to my soul tonight. And, you know, Brother Tony, he might can tell me after I make this comment. I guess it's been maybe even a year ago now. One afternoon, he shared with me on Facebook a song that was called I Would Not Be Denied. Church tonight, I cannot think of anything tonight any worse than being denied to be in heaven. And I want to be thankful, Lord, when we arrive on heaven's bright shore, and I know that heaven's worth it all. Amen.
Amen.
So I'll sing a second verse of that. Amen. Y'all get ready. Brother Tony's already ready. He's ready to preach tonight. And we're going to let the Lord use him tonight. The Lord's going to be good to us. But tonight, church, we got to get our mind on heaven. Amen.
Amen.
It's wonderful. It's going to be good. Amen. Don't know exactly. I've heard a lot of people tell me. I've had a lot of people suggest to me. I've heard a lot of comments about it. I've heard a lot of preaching about heaven. But I believe when I see it with my own eyes, Brother Tim, that I believe I'm going to see something nobody's yet been able to tell me all about. Amen tonight. But heaven is surely going to be worth it all. Amen tonight. So we're going to ask you to sing that last verse one more time. Amen. I really don't understand everything that he saw on the Isle of Patmos, but this I do know, he saw enough. He saw enough that he caught a glimpse there. And you know, tonight, church, if we could just catch a glimpse of heaven, amen. Just think about it, if you just catch a glimpse of heaven. No matter what you're going through, no matter what your trouble load is tonight, but church, if we could just get a glimpse of heaven on our mind, Here to be, you know, I go into hospice houses and I hear people say, well, they'll be better off in a few more minutes, or they'll be better off in a few more days. Well, we don't know that because we don't know the condition of the soul. But poor mama got real sick. She told me, she said, Brian, she said, she called me up to the house one day. Brother Tony, my mama asked me. She said, Brian, reckon what heaven's going to be like. I said, Mama, I said, I don't really know. And I told her what I knew from the scripture. She said, well, she said, reckon really what it's going to be like. I said, Mama, I said, are you prepared to go to heaven? I said, do you know the Lord is your Savior? Now, Mama been raised in church, but I needed to know that my mama knew, that she knew the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. She said, Brian, she said, I'm going to see what heaven's all about. I'm ready to go. I gathered around Mama's bed, and me and Sherry was on one side, and Brendan and David was on the other side, and I told her, I said, Mama, Mama's easing up toward heaven. Wasn't but a few more minutes, Mama was gone. I stood there. I didn't see any sign that Mama wanted to come back. I didn't see any sign that Mama, I just seen a peaceful look on Mama's face, and I said, well, Mama's all right now, amen. And I'm not all right, but she's quite well. She's home now. And I don't know why I want to think about heaven tonight, church, but it's real tonight, amen. Am I going to take up a I'm going to get started singing another song about heaven, and I reckon you'll preach in a minute, Brother Tony. I don't know. Well, we'll get there in a minute, all
just
right?
Just find the Lord.
We'll get there in a minute. So I'll sing us another song about heaven. Y'all ready to go tonight? I'm ready. Amen.
Amen.
I won't carry some more people with me, but it's going to be their loss if I leave without them. Amen. When the Lord descends with a shout, I'm not going to wait on them. Amen. I'm through with that. Amen. I'm through preaching. It's all heaven then. Amen.
Amen.
All right, Silas, if you'll sing us
a song. Let's all sing page 312 together in the red book. Page 312.
And then be ready, faithful, be.
this morning, preaching the word from over in the Old Testament gospel. And tonight, we're just anticipating another good move of the Lord tonight. And so just to come back tomorrow night, 7 o'clock through Wednesday night. And some of you have asked me, it'll be Tuesday night, it'll be Elisha and Isaac will be singing for us Tuesday night. So I just wanted to put that out there that several of you have asked about that. So that'll take place Tuesday night. Then, all right, Brother Tony, you ready to preach, brother?
All right. Amen.
It's good to have an amen tonight. In the preaching of the word. Amen. All right.
Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
Good to see all of you. Thankful for you. Thankful for what we've been a part of already tonight.
Yes,
a good place to be. These songs have stirred our heart, and we're thankful of that. And just to know that we're an old-time Christian, as we said this
That's
morning,
right.
And we've got a better place to go. I'm looking forward to that place of heaven that they were singing about. I'm like Brother Brian. I don't know a whole lot what it's going to be like over yonder. I really don't read much in the scriptures of description of heaven. But I know it's going to be good.
Yes, see,
I know it's better than what we've got down here.
Yes, see,
and I know I have a desire to go there. And I want to be there more than anything on this earth. Praise the Lord for that hope that we've got. And I also know, on the other hand, that there's a bad place that I don't want to go to.
That's exactly right.
Eternal torment, fire, brimstone, and an awful, awful place. And the Lord actually spent a lot more time warning people about that place than he did heaven.
Uh-huh.
But isn't it good when we come together like this and our mind gets elevated to heavenly things?
Yes.
As Paul began to describe one time, that we are able to sit together in heavenly places.
That's right.
I'm glad we're in a heavenly place here this evening with God's people.
Amen.
That our minds have been elevated above the problems and the cares of this world, that we're able to press through and go right on to a better place. I'm with some folks tonight. I hope, as they sang that last song, I can meet you in the morning.
That's right.
I want to be over
there. Amen, brother.
For that. Appreciate, again, the opportunity to be here. Have a wonderful day. Don't know how well I'm going to do tonight. That food that Brother Brian's family, Sister April, Sister Irene, we had a wonderful meal after church, and I just about ate until I popped. And went home and laid down and fell asleep and woke up and got in a rut, and I'm not going to say I was late this evening. I'm just going to say I didn't get started on time. But we finally made it. We're glad to be here. I don't like walking in late like that, but it is what it is. We're thankful you all said and pray for us. I hope you'll ask the Lord to help us this evening, as Brother Brian said this morning, that we can get some help here tonight. Not that I could be able to help you, but that the Lord, through His Spirit, might be able to direct our minds and give us exactly what we need. That we could be fed, strengthened. And I don't know the hearts and minds of anybody here, but we might be able to be edified as His church and strengthened as a part of His church. And most importantly, I don't know if there's an unsaved in the building or not, but that lifeline can be thrown out.
Yes.
And that one might begin to understand where they stand before it's final and everlasting too late. But they can be able to say, I'm going to heaven, rather than that horrible place of torment. That's what began to set that fear in my life, that I might begin to walk for Jesus while I'm living here. This morning we spoke in the book of 2 Kings in chapter 2, and I want to jump over a few verses from that. But I just, before I leave chapter 2, I normally don't stay in an area like this when I'm preaching, but it just seems like this book and these few chapters of Elisha have been sticking out in my mind, and we just want to try to allow the Lord to lead us, so you all pray. And I say this a lot of times up home, that I want to be just as much like John Baptist as I can. I want to decrease so that my Lord can increase. And that should be the mind of every one of us. But as we stop there this morning in the book of 2 Kings in chapter 2, we got to the point and actually touched on it just a little bit when Elisha came to the point that he had asked Elijah for a double portion. And the Lord granted that, as we find in chapter 2 there, in verse 12, that Elisha was blessed to see all that took place there when the chariot of fire came and took Elijah away. And as we find him going through everything that he went through and experienced there that day, that he got a double portion of what was going on. And he said in verse 15 of chapter 2, I'm not going to stay in chapter 2, I'm going to jump over to chapter 4 or 5 here in a minute. But he said there in chapter 2, verse 15, and when the sons of the prophets which were to view at Jericho saw him, they said, the spirit of Elijah doth rest on Elisha. And they came to meet him and bowed themselves to the ground before him. As they began to look upon this man, they saw that the Spirit of God, that God's hand, was upon Elisha just as much as it had been upon Elijah. Today, as God's hand is upon us, we should be able to be a witness and have favor with those people that's around us, that they can understand that we're something different than what they are. But he was filled with something there that day. Now the Spirit back at this time began to work a little differently than it does today. We today are blessed to have the Holy Spirit come inside of these bodies of ours and dwell in this tabernacle. That's what this body is the tabernacle or the temple for the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. Now, under the law, under this dispensation of time that we're reading of here in 2 Kings, they didn't have the Spirit like we have it tonight, that it came down on occasion and would guide this one or abode upon this one and direct their thoughts or their minds, and it would even be blessed to have their mouth open and God would fill it. But today, he's instructed us ministers that are here now to study to show ourselves approved, that God's able to direct our minds. But we can't just open our mouth here tonight and God give us the words physically or that we have naturally to say. We've got to lean upon the Lord for understanding. But as we looked at this scripture this morning, and we saw that Elisha had a desire to follow after Elijah, that he had a want to in his life to go the direction that he needed to go, we find that he set forth in the next couple of chapters doing God's will, and we come to chapter 4. This is where I want to land at this evening, in chapter 4 of the book of 2 Kings. And keep in mind that Elisha had the Spirit of God that came down and began to abide upon him, and those sons of the prophets recognized that he was God's man and that he was one that God was being blessed by as he walked here upon this earth. Even after that, we find that those sons, and I don't want to continue to stay in chapter 2, but I can't hardly get away from it to get where I am tonight, so you all just bear with me for a minute, okay? But we find that as the Spirit came down upon Elisha there that day, and those sons of the prophets recognized it. Those sons of the prophets actually told Elisha, well, we're going to go over here to a mountain and see if maybe that's where God sent down Elijah at when that chariot of fire came by. And then he said, maybe we'll go over here in this valley and do this. But you know what? Elisha had faith that he knew that when that chariot of fire came down to get him, that he was taken to a higher place, that he was taken to a better world than what we're experiencing here in this life. And that's what we need to understand today. When God calls one of his children home, that it's much better than anything that we've ever experienced on this earth, that there is a rest that doth remain for the people of God. And I thank God for that. But as we go over here, still looking at Elisha doing God's work, I want to go to chapter 4 and read just a few verses here, starting in verse 1. And this is a story, if you will, about a widow who had lost just about everything she had, and she's found herself in a bad predicament that she don't have any money. And the creditors, the ones that have come to get what they're owed by this lady, and maybe that her husband, as we're going to find down through here, was one that got them in debt for some reason, and we'll touch on that for just a minute as well. But she was in a bad predicament, and here she was with no money. They're about to take everything she's got, and listen what takes place here in this chapter. Chapter 4, verse 1, I want to read about 7 verses here, if it be the Lord's will. It says, now, there cried a certain woman of the wives of the sons of the prophets unto Elisha, saying, thy servant, my husband, is dead. And thou knowest that thy servant did fear the Lord, and the creditor is come to take unto him my 2 sons to be bondmen. Then Elisha said unto her, what shall I do for thee? Tell me, what hast thou in the house? And she said, thine handmaid hath not anything in the house save a pot of oil. Then he said, go, borrow thee vessels abroad of thy neighbors,
Empty, even empty vessels, borrow not a few. And when thou art come, thou shalt shut the door upon thee and upon thy sons, and shalt pour out unto all those vessels, and shalt set aside that which is full. So she went from him, went from Elisha, and shut the door upon her and upon her sons who brought the vessels to her, and she poured out. And it came to pass, when the vessels were full, that she said unto her sons, bring me yet a vessel. And he said unto her, there is not a vessel more, and the oil stayed. Then she came and told the man of God, and he said, go, sell the oil, and pay thy debt, and live thou and thy children and the rest. Thank God for how God worked in this lady's life right there. Now, as we look at this situation that this woman was in right there, we want to understand that she had came, as a lot of folks today would say, she came to the end of her rope. It looked like things were pretty bleak. It looked like things were going south, if you will. And she was in a bad way. It came to the point that the bank, or the creditors, as the scripture calls it there in verse 1, had come, and they were about to take her only two sons to be bondmen, to be slaves unto these creditors, because she owed them such a great debt. Now, I don't know altogether exactly, but history does teach this, and I don't like to lean upon history, but it begins to make a little more sense as we begin to look at the story. So I'm just going to throw this in there, and we'll try to move on. But to begin to look at Jewish history, and you're going to find that over in the book of Kings, prior to this, in 1 Kings about chapter 18, there was a man by the name of Obadiah, and he had to go, and he was taking care of some prophets there after that Jezebel had came, and she began to destroy all the prophets. She was slaying everyone that was serving God, and she began to try to martyr everyone that was doing God's will there at the time. And Obadiah, the scripture lets us know over there, began to take in several of these prophets, 100 prophets, if you will, and separated them by two and hid them in two caves. And there, the scripture teaches us that he fed those prophets while he had them hid from old Jezebel. Now, Jewish history teaches us that that man had to borrow some money in order to keep those people fed there. And then we find that as time began to go on, that old man Obadiah died. And in chapter 4 here of 2 Kings, we're told by Jewish history that that is Obadiah's widow that has come here. So we see the sons of the prophets that are here witnessing all of this in this chapter in verse 1, where it says, a woman of the wives of the sons of the prophets, they came unto Elisha, the servant that came to him here, that was a servant that was dead. So her husband had died. The creditors are coming to get her children. She doesn't have anything to pay the creditor for. So she calls out to Elisha. And Elisha tells her to go get oil. Go what you've got in your house, the only thing that she has. And she begins to take that after she gathers all the vessels that she could find in her neighborhood, from her neighbors and from her own house. And she began to go in and separated herself from everybody else except her and her sons. And she began to pour out the oil that she did have in all of those vessels. And you know what? Every time she'd fill one vessel up, she'd go to the next one, and there was still a little more in that vessel. And then she'd go to another, and there was still in there, until she got to every bowl, every vessel that she had, that she had borrowed. It was full. And then God told her through the mouth of Elisha, you go and you sell that oil, and you'll have enough to pay off the debt that you owe. You see, that oil was very, very precious back at that time. It was something that they needed for life. It was something they needed to cook with. It was something that was very, very precious. We could even go over and begin to read about a man one time that began to be set over the sellers of oil that were there under King David. And it said that this man that was there was a man that began to give his whole time, his whole life to this oil. world because it was very valuable. And even at that time under King David, he knew that where the oil was stored, that it had to be kept secret. It had to be top secret, because that's the first thing that an enemy was going to try to steal, because they knew how valuable that oil was, and that it would be able, if they got their oil, they wouldn't be able to have anything to eat, they wouldn't be able to cook, and they wouldn't have any light to shine out. So that was considered a very valuable asset. And we find that in this story here, that it's still very valuable. And tonight we need to understand what that oil is to us. We've just read about a story here, and if you just take this story at face value, you're not going to get much out of it. But when we begin to look at the scripture and understand now in the New Testament of what this oil might be, you're going to find that each and every one of us in this building, in this world today, that we need an anointing. The old Baptist family, they don't like that word. They don't like to hear about an anointing. But I'm thankful tonight that I've been anointed from a hand from up above, that He's came down and He's touched this boy, just like the old man of God began to proclaim in the book of Psalms when he began to speak about this anointing that took place, that he said began to run down upon the beard, even Aaron's beard, and went right on down to the skirts of his garment, and there the Lord commanded the blessing. And we find that David even recorded it there in the 23rd Psalm that we're so familiar with, when he said, "Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over." How good it is tonight to know of the Spirit of God that comes down and touches individuals, that we can be filled up here this evening, just like this woman said, that every vessel that she brought into her house was filled up from the top that she had in every room that she began to go and fill that up. It was blessed in every vessel to go out, just like that time that we find the other old prophet began to come when he came to a woman that he was just there rubbing two sticks together. And it's, she was asked, "What are you going to do with those two sticks?" And she said, "I'm going to build a fire. I'm going to bake a cake. And me and the child were going to die." Why? Because they ran out of resources. They had a little bit of meal in a barrel. And just like this widow, she just had a little bit of oil in her cruse. But the writer lets us know there, as he began to explain what had taken place, that he said, "Go, give me something to eat," the prophet said. And she fixed him something. And we find that as she continued to go back to that meal barrel, that there was still meal in that barrel. And there was still oil in the cruse. Just like this woman, God has an endless supply for His people here upon this earth. And if we will desire, we also as a vessel in God can be able to be filled, and we can have the blessing of that Holy Spirit coming down to us this evening. That if we are willing, He's not going to force us, as we said this morning when we began to speak about going out to our unsaved, that we shouldn't try to force feed them. We shouldn't try to force them to do things against what they want. We should try to persuade them through the scripture and allow God to lead our mind and our testimony and the word, so that we might be able to help them in some way. Because God is not going to force any of us to have that oil in our vessel, but we ought to be willing to be filled up down here as we go along, that we can be a vessel that's fit to be able to hold in that precious Holy Spirit of God. And as we see it beginning to be outpoured, there's a lot of things the scripture will teach us that we can be filled with. And there's a lot of things that you can put in your mind and in your life that's not very good. There's wrath, there's anger that you can fill your mind and your heart with. There is unrighteousness that we can fill our lives with. There is lies that come from the devil that we can fill our lives with. But God doesn't want us to be filled with the things of this world. Rather, He wants us to be filled with the Holy Ghost. We find Him preaching one day when He began to proclaim on the Sermon on the mount, and he spoke and he said, blessed are they that do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. I'm thankful today that if we have a desire, that if we have a want to be filled, that we can have our belly filled, not of the things of this world. We had a wonderful dinner today, but you know what, as Jesus told the folks there that day, hey, you eat of this natural bread, you're going to hunger again, but the bread that I give you, ye shall eat thereof and never die. Thank God tonight that we're serving a God that's able to fill us up.
Yes, sir.
He's able to give us what we need. He's able to supply our needs as we go through this world. Isn't he a good God tonight to know what we need, just like he spoke there that day to those folks with that great, great multitude that had gathered there, and he began to look around and he told them to sit, and you know what? They didn't have anything to feed that great multitude with but a few fishes and a few loaves of bread. But what did our Lord do? He took little and he began to ask God to bless that little, and then he was able to allow that whole great multitude of 5,000 people to be fed, and they were filled when they ate it, and they were satisfied. And so today God is able. We may not think that we're much. We may think, I'm not a preacher, I'm not a singer, I'm not a public spokesman to pray, or I can't do anything in the church. But tonight we need to understand that God can take a little bit, and he can multiply that, just as we said this morning. If we can just say the name of Jesus and how good he is to us, and thankful that we are, that he saved our soul, that God's able to magnify that and have an impact on people that's around us, that it might be able to persuade them, have influence upon them, give us favor with them as we're living here on this earth. That's how God works. And as we look at these folks right here, she said that she was down to the end. She didn't know anywhere to go. She did all that she knew to do. Just like the woman with the issue of blood, she's done everything she knew to do to get better. But the issue of her blood disease, she got worse. And the scripture teaches her she had faith, and she said, if I can just but touch the hem of his garment, I know that I can be healed. And she done just that, as she pressed through that crowd and got to where Jesus was. He was on his way to heal, to be with another family that was grieving, another family that had trouble, but it didn't delay him. It didn't cause him to be distracted, but she reached out, didn't yell, didn't scream like blind Bartimaeus did, sitting there by the wayside, but she just reached out and grabbed the hem of his garment, and Jesus stopped and said, somebody has touched me. For I perceive virtue has gone out from me. And he looked at that woman, he said, thy faith hath made thee whole.
Yes.
Today our faith that we can obtain from hearing the gospel can allow us to be filled up with the Spirit of God.
That's
if we have that desire, if we have that want to, going back again, blessed are they that hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. And when we understand the newness that he can fill us up with today, Jesus began to speak another time when he began to let the folks know, you don't take old bottles and pour new wine into those old bottles. Why? Because when you pour that new wine into old bottles, you're going to find that when the fermentation process begins, that it's going to cause those bottles to have pressure, and it's going to bust the bottles, and the wine is going to be spilled. He went on to say, you don't take a new piece of cloth and begin to sew it on an old piece of cloth, because when you begin to start washing that garment, you sisters know about new clothes, and if you wash them and you start wearing them, then they're going to begin to stretch and they're going to begin to move. That's exactly how that patch will work. You don't put that on that garment, but rather you put a new patch on a new garment and an old patch on an old garment. You put new wine in new bottles, and God today is able to make us new down on the inside and make a new work on the inside of us by the Holy Spirit of God through the new birth. he can begin to clean us up on the inside so that he can fill us up with that Holy Spirit. We're able to feel that as we go through this life. How do we know we've passed from death unto life? Because we love the brother. We've got that love in our heart. Where did that love come from? From God. God is love. We have that dwelling in us. He's going to help us as we go through this world. Now this woman, as she came there, she was in a bad way. She didn't have nowhere else to turn, but she thought she could turn to the man of God and get some help. Today we may be at the end of our rope. We may not know anywhere else to go. When we were in our sins and we were lost, we didn't have any other direction that we could go but to hear what the man of God had to tell us, and it can lead us in the right direction to get what we need. But in order, as we even spoke this morning about Naaman, as we spoke about the children walking around the walls of Jericho, they had to be obedient. They had to go all the way with God. This woman had to be obedient. Even though she had faith, she still had to put some works with that faith and stepped out, and she done what the prophet had told her to do by gathering all those vessels together. And when she stepped out in obedience, she found that the oil was able to stay, that there was an endless supply of that oil for her and her son. And today the same thing can happen to us if we will continue in the route and obtain the faith that God will bless us to get by hearing the gospel message and beginning to step out in obedience on that faith that we do obtain from that. Because the writer lets us know that faith, if you have works with it, that you're going in the right direction. Bless God, you cannot have faith without works, for the writer said it is dead. Faith without works is dead. Just like the body without the spirit is dead. Faith being alone is dead. You can believe. You can say, the Bible lets us know that the devils believe and tremble. So just believing doesn't get it. There has to be some action. There has to be some work. And this woman, she stepped out in faith. And she done what this prophet told her to do. When she done obediently what God instructed her through the mouth of that prophet, she was able to get her debt taken care of. She was able to keep her sons. God was able to help her situation because first she had faith, second she was obedient, and third she followed through and didn't give up. Just like Elisha began to continue following after Elijah, as we spoke this morning, as she was continually following the leadership of what God wanted her to do. And this evening we should do the same thing as we go through this life. That we could have that new life placed down on the inside of these vessels of ours and continue through the way. As we look back to the old scriptures, we'll find, as we talked about this, getting filled up. And that's what I'd like for us to keep in our mind. If you don't get anything out of this service this evening, I want you to just begin to think about and remember that we need to be filled up. You're not going to be empty in this world. People will say, I'm empty, I feel like there's nothing there. But you are either full of this world, you're full of the deceitfulness, you're full of sin, or you can be filled with the Holy Spirit of God. One or the other is what we've got in our life. And God wants us to be able to be cleansed with the washing of the water of the Word of God. The Scripture teaches us that it can clean up the inside and allow us to be able to have more of Him in us, to be less of us, as we spoke a while ago, as John Baptist said, that I may decrease and that the Lord may increase. That we can empty ourselves, and we cannot do it by ourselves tonight. So church, you need to realize you can't do it by yourself. That you've got to lean on the Lord to empty ourselves of all of our selfish motives, of all of our greed, of all of our sinful pride, of all of these things that the book of Romans in the first chapter begins to speak about. That we should set off to the side. If we do that, he's able to move in. The old timers, when they go clean out a well, Some of you are well acquainted with what a well is. There's a spring down there that these old hand dug wells, especially, they go down and have it lined with rocks, and they get down to where they got the spring and the water started flowing in and fill up the well. But as time began to go on, especially in those hand-dug wells, you know what happened? Leaves and dirt and debris would fall in that well, and it would stop up the spring, and the spring would stop filling up the well. They'd run out of water. And I'm afraid that there's too many times in our life as a Christian that we allow the trash of this world and the sin of our lives to come into our lives and stop up the well. What did he tell the woman there at the well that day when he spoke to her about this water? He said that if you would have asked of me, I would have given you living water. You drink the water that's coming out of this well, Jacob's well, you're going to thirst again. But the water that I give you, you can drink of and never thirst. He said it would be a well of living water springing up on the inside of you unto everlasting life. But the problem with so many of us is the problem that we can't really have true revival in our own personal lives is because we allow this trash to come in and it slows down the trickle of that well. We allow something else to occupy us. It may occupy our time. The things may occupy our mind to keep us from doing and meditating or praying or studying and reading. It may occupy us enough to keep us out of a church service like this right here. But you know what they had to do back in Abraham's time? They went to a new city, they dug the wells, and you know what happened as soon as the enemy came in? I stressed about the importance of the oil and how the enemy came in and would have to take the oil away from their enemy. And one other thing they would try to get and to take advantage of was their water source. And they knew if they got their water source, they'd eventually have the best of their enemy. So they come in and they find their wells and they fill them up with dirt. And then we find later down the road, here came another group in that the wells they found that were filled up. What did they do? They dug again the wells so that the water could start flowing. I'm afraid we're letting the enemy too many times by this. He's very sly. He's very subtle in how that he works. He may come in and get your mind occupied. He may have a worry. He loves to get you worrying. He loves to get you anxious, get you thinking about that more than you're thinking about God and His church. He may get you so occupied with things that aren't necessarily sinful, that if you can make them a sin, though, if you allow them to separate you from the priorities that God wants you to have, that we put God as number one. He said that He is a jealous God and will have no other gods before Him. So tonight, if we're not real careful, we'll let the things... Let's go and begin to look at what the writer began to speak about running the race that's set before Him. He said to run the race, look to Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. He said, lay aside every weight and the sin that doth so easily beset us. The weight and the sin that doth so easily beset us. There may be some weights in our daily life, in our home life, in our work life, that cause us to slow down in the service of God, running the race for Him. And then there may be some actual sins that we let creep in that cause us to slow down, that cause that well that we have, just like in Abraham's day, the well got filled up by the trash and by the enemy that came along and stopped that spring from flowing up. So let's be filled with the things that God wants us to do, because you see, He's got an endless supply of that Spirit for us. We don't have to worry about it running out. Just like this lady, it was able to fill up every vessel that she had there in that home. Today, God's Spirit is able to fill up every vessel that I'm looking at in this building tonight. It's able to come in and take up its abode on the inside of us if we want it to, if we desire it, if we want Him to do His will in our life. He will come in. He's a gentleman this evening, and He's not going to force His way in. He'll meekly knock at our heart's door. We put that to our unsaved, and He does knock at our unsaved's door. But this evening, we need need to understand there may be times as a Christian that he's knocking at our heart, wanting us to go in this direction, or nudging us to go into that direction, to be obedient unto him. So this evening, let's have our ears tuned in to that Holy Spirit, so that it can lead us in the right direction as we go through this world. Because when we do, we're in tune with that. We can be just like, we spoke of John Baptist a while ago. You know what happened when he was there in his mother's womb, and here came Mary into the room and began to speak to Elizabeth, his mother. You know what the Bible said? It said that that baby John began to leap with joy inside of Elizabeth's womb, filled with that Holy Spirit. Today we can also, and when we're in the presence of God, when we feel, just as we felt it here, I felt his presence already here tonight while we were singing, that we can feel his presence and we can be filled up. But the problem is when we've got our cup setting up too many times by our own greed and our own selfish desires, we turn that cup upside down because of our own wants, and we don't allow his Spirit to come in because of our disobedience. But how good it is when we get in a condition, when we're prayed up, when we've been out close prayer meeting time on our own, found us a closet somewhere where we can steal away and pray with God, and then we begin to feel that Holy Spirit come in and begin to fill us, and begin to allow our heart to overflow just like these old timers would do. I remember them having my uncle having a little cup of tea or coffee, and he began to pour it out into his saucer. How good it is when you fill that cup up and it just runs right out into the saucer, and you can begin to fill it, overflow that as well. And my God has an endless supply tonight. He had an endless supply of meal for that one widow, had an endless supply of oil for her. He had an endless supply for this lady who had done all and came to the end of her rope. You may be at the end of your rope tonight in your life. Your family may be driving you crazy. Your grandkids may be pressuring you with all kinds of worry. Your spouse, your family may be having difficult times in your life. Your job may have you stressed out. Let me encourage you tonight. Begin to empty yourself of all of those things. I'm not saying quit your job. I'm not saying turn your back on your family. No, that's not what I'm saying. But put God as number one. Get your mind where that it needs to be. Hey, think on these things. The scripture teaches us that we can have our mind focused while we're running that race, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. I'm thankful that he's the one that wrote that faith into my life. He's the author of it. When I first heard the gospel message, and one day after a while, as the brother began to speak a while ago, Brother Brian spoke about how beautiful heaven is going to be when we get there. You know what? When we get there, the scripture teaches us faith will end inside. I'm not going to need faith anymore, Brother Brian. I'm not going to need hope anymore when I get over there. That's why the writer said the greatest of these three, faith, hope, and charity, is charity. Because I thank my God above that the love of God is going to extend right on beyond on this world into heaven's country. What a blessing that is, to know that we've got him. And if we'll do what that we want and not be filling ourselves with the things of this world. We've talked about the good things that we can fill ourselves with. But you know what? If we're not real cautious, as we went there to the book of Romans, we may read there in just a minute, of all those bad things that we can have our life filled with. And there was a man one time, the scripture teaches us, that he began to ask his father for all of his inheritance. And he began to beg that he could have it. And you know what he did when he got it? He left there and he began to go spend all that he had in riotous living. He spent it all. And you know where he found himself? He found himself down at the hog pen. And it said he would have fain eaten eaten the husk. He said he would have filled himself with the husk that the hogs did eat. That was something that was very unwanting of a Jew. They thought that the swine were unclean. They believed that they weren't allowed to be around it. It was an unclean animal given by Scripture. But here this prodigal was. He found himself down. He found that he spent everything that he had. He found that he was empty spiritually. And here he was down as low as he could go, and he would have filled himself with the husk that the hogs did eat. But he began to think about Father's house. And when he thought about Father's house, he said, I know that my Father has servants that's fair and better than I am here in this hog pen. He said, I know what I'll do. I'll go to Father's house and I'll say to him, Father, make me as one of thy hired servants. I've sinned against thee. So he picked himself up. Sometimes when all this from our job, our family, our home, our own personal life with our health maybe begins to bog us down, sometimes we just need to pick ourselves up. You may say, well, I'm waiting for the Lord to do that. That boy had to make the first step. I had to make the first step when I was unsaved. And when I made that first step, God honored that. When we start moving, He'll move with us. How good He is when He moves that way. That boy got up from that hog pen, set back to Father's house. Father knew the direction that he was going to be coming. He was looking down the road and watching for his son to come. And when he saw him, he told the people, his family, his servants, hey, go kill the fatted calf. That which is lost is found. That which is dead is alive. Get a ring and put on his finger. And my son has come home. Uh-huh. He came to his father. He began to give him a robe, put it around him, began to welcome him into his home there that day. But the other son that had been there all along said, Father, we've been here all this time. Oh, today let's understand that God loves us. He wants us to come to Him. He wants us to do His will. We think that things have to be fair and equal all on a broad spectrum. I found out a long time ago, especially working in the school system, that fair is not always equal. Fair is not always equal. And it's not always equal in God's eyes either. Now I know He's put us all on one level. He's told us in the Scripture there's no more Jew, no more Greek, no more bond or free, but we're all now in the same family, but He knows exactly what you're made up of, and He knows what I'm made up of because He made us. Uh-huh. He knows all about us. So that boy was filled with the wrong thing, but he had a change of mind, and he started getting himself emptied of the wrong thing. So sometimes we need to make a point to get the Father's house, to get the help we need to empty us so that we can be filled like this woman right here was. We can, when we do that, it'll be just like that day of Pentecost there. We just studied up home in a Bible study about what took place that day. And they began to come into that upper room, all these folks there on that day of Pentecost. And you know what happened when they came in with one mind, one accord? It said the Spirit of God filled the whole house wherein they were sitting. So today let's have a desire to be filled with Him. Let's have a desire to work for Him. If we've got that desire and a want to, hey, this evening, it don't take a big, big, huge congregation to have a movement of the Spirit. It don't take a house full of folks to be able to have a revival here this evening. God loves to move in small, just like we spoke there just a minute ago with that little handful of oil that she had in that little cruise. Just like Jesus just had a few fishes and a few loaves of bread, that He can take just a few. He just took 12 men, 11 actually, and He began to change and turn this world upside down, and it began to spread like wildfire. And just think what God can do with this group that's right here tonight, that He can start moving in our lives and He can influence us, whether you're young, whether you're old. You may think I'm not able. You may think I'm too inexperienced. God's able to take your inability. He's very well aware of what you're not capable of doing, and He's able to make you capable of doing. God knew that little David wasn't capable in his own self to even prove that armor when he put Saul's armor upon him. But praise God, he went forth and he let those folks know, yeah. I'm not coming to him in my name. I'm not coming to him in any other name. But he told that giant right to his face, I come to you in the name of the Lord. And he's able to take a little ruddy boy like David was, as a shepherd that was looked down upon. Hey, the old prophet and his own family didn't even recognize him as one to be ordained or be set aside and anointed as king over Israel. The prophet came to Nathan's house, and Nathan said, as he sent all these boys there except for David. And the prophet looked up on the table at all the boys of Nathan that was there, or Jesse's that was there, and he said, do you have any more sons? Yeah, I've got one. He's a little ruddy fella, and he's out there taking care of the sheep. Let's go see him, the prophet said. Went out there and saw him, and he said, that's the one. And you know what he did? He anointed him there that day to become king over Israel. Was he put in that position immediately? In God's eyes, he was already king. But several days, several weeks, several months had to transpire before David was physically upon the throne. God had some work that had to be done. Today, God may have a purpose in our lives. Whether we're young, whether we're old, whether we're able physically or not, God can take what we have, and he knows. He's that high tower. He's way up there. And when you're up on a mountain, you can see a whole lot further out in front of you than when you're down on the ground. God's up there, and he can see way out in front of us. And he knows, and he's preparing us for what's coming in the future. So if we'll just listen to him, he's able to help us get to that point. And it may be down the road that our prayers don't get answered the way that we think they should. And it may be that they get answered way down the road, further than we expect them to get answered. But he's still able to answer them. He finally put David up in that seat of authority, in that throne there. He's able to take a little and make much out of it. He's able to fill us with his Holy Spirit if we're willing, if we're desirous of it. And if you're not a Christian this evening, oh, the best thing that I could ever advise you to do is to get to know this man called Jesus and be filled with that Spirit. Well, you've just been talking about we as Christians need to get filled again. Yeah, there's times that we've not completely lost the Spirit of God, that it's abiding upon us, but oh, how good it is when he comes and he overshadows us and overflows that Spirit in us. And we know, just as Brother Brian said, I know that I know that I know that I'm a child of his. I like those confirmations from God when he comes by and begins to let me know, yeah, I'm still yours. I like those little times that he gives me a foretaste of what heaven's going to be like out there in the future. What a blessing that is to know that he loves us and that he helps us as we go through this world. And if we'll continue his way, he's able to help us. I'll close with this. One time the Lord began to say, as they were out there in the ship, these boys had been fishing all night. Those apostles, they were very skilled fishermen. That was their trade. That's what they lived. And I've said down home a lot of times that the Lord would go into a village of fishermen, and you know what he'd talk about? He'd talk about fishing to them so that they could understand heavenly things. He'd go into a village of farmers, and he'd talk in parables about farming, like sowing the seed, and how that they needed to understand the mustard seed. He would relate to them, make it relevant to their life. He came to these fishermen one day. He knew they'd been toiling all night out on the deep, and they didn't catch anything. They didn't catch one fish. And the Lord said, throw your net over on the other side. Now those boys probably had all night threw it on that side and that side, over there. They had gone in every direction, no doubt, throwing that net. In other words, they knew about fishing. They weren't ignorant of that. No doubt they mumbled and complained, but they followed through, just like we said a minute ago with the woman, just like we said with these other situations, with Jericho, just like we spoke about Naaman being obedient. They followed through and they were obedient. And they threw the net over on the other side after doing all night trying to catch a fish. And you know what happened? They couldn't even pull the net up. They had to have some help. Yep. And it was filled with all manner of fishes. God's able to fill us up.
Yes, he is.
Right. He's able to take care of us. He loves us. He cares for us. Going back to the scripture that I mentioned when I first blessed blessed. Blessed means to be happy. Blessed are they that do hunger and thirst after righteousness. We've got to desire it. It takes a want to. You got to want it. When we have a desire to grow closer to God, we have a desire to be filled with His Spirit. Then once we get filled, desire to have even more of it so that we can get closer and closer and closer to God. We just studied not too long. I know I said I was going to quit. One thing brings on another. We were just studying just to preach, I think it was last Sunday, about some of the things that God has told us to do. And He began to put some things into a category of some of the basic elementary things that we as Christians should know. And He started rebuking those folks there when He wrote the letter to them that they were still on the milk of the Word. And they should be able to teach others. So today, if we're not to the point that we can grow and we can begin to help somebody else rather than being just a weak Christian, we've got some moving up to do. We've got some growing to do. We've got some maturing to do. God loves us and He wants to take care of us.
Yes, He does.
If you're not a Christian, we'd encourage you to get on that milk. The Lord will allow you to grow. You may not have it all figured out when you get it, but He's going to direct you in the right way. As you go a little stronger and a little stronger, He'll give you some good brothers and sisters to encourage you along as well. I'm glad for those brothers and sisters that I've got that helps the feeble hands, the weak knees, helps us as we go through this life with encouragement. So thank God for everything that He's done. We love you this evening. Leave here with this. Let's be filled with what He wants us to be filled with. If you get the opportunity to go read the first chapter of the book of Romans, it'll tell you some bad things that if we're not real careful, that we can have our lives filled with. Read that and you'll begin to do a self-examination, a self-inventory. Do I have any of those things that Paul told the church at Rome that they shouldn't have? And if we do, we should get that out of our life to make room for the good things of God to start taking its place while that we live. We love you this evening. May God bless you. We'll turn it back over to Brother Brian.
Wow, Brother Tony was preaching, my mind went to a song that I heard many years ago. It says that there was one drop shed just for me, talking about the blood. And you know, tonight, I think tonight, all the oil we need, everything we need is found still in the blood of the Lamb of God. Aren't you thankful tonight for the blood of the Lamb of God that He's able?
Amen.
And tonight, if you're not saved tonight, the blood could do you well tonight. Tonight, if you walk away from the Lord, the blood can still do you well.
Amen.
Tonight. And you know, tonight, anything that we have, all of our hope, is found in the blood of the Lamb of God.
Amen.
Now, how about that? Brother Tony was preaching, and he shared with us many parables through the Bible about where God was faithful. But church, tonight, it all begins with the blood, and sometimes we have to still go back to the blood, and we're going to give you a time of invitation tonight. And I thought that while he was preaching, I said, Lord, what would you have us to do for an invitational song? I thought about the old song that says, are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
A good one.
Now, you know, now, let's go back to our childhood when we might take a bath. Sometimes my grandmama, she'd check me and see if I really bathed or not. And you know, tonight, church, sometimes we have to check ourselves out. Yeah. Are we under the blood tonight?
Amen.
And church, tonight, anything that you need can be found at the cross.
That's right, Mom.
At the cross tonight. If you need oil tonight, if you need a fulfillment, if you need healing, we can find it at the cross tonight.
That's right.
So let's stand with hymn number 177. Says, are you washed in the blood of the Lamb of God? And tonight, think about that and ask the Lord to lead your heart tonight, would you come?
Lord.
As we sing it together for prayer, for yourself, or for someone, or for the revival, most of all, in honor of our Lord tonight, come close and nudge up to Him tonight. Let's sing it together, Silas.
Have you been to Jesus, Lord, like are you washed in the blood?
Tonight, if you need to push out and come, if you're a desire.
just pray.
When the bridegroom comes, will your robes be white, and white in the blood of the Lamb? Will your soul be ready for the mansion?
Will there be others tied?
Be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Are you are you washed in the blood?
we thank you for the blood that's able to take away the sins of this life. And Father, we thank you for the blood that has covered the sins, and you have taken them into the seal of forgiveness, never to remember them no more.
Yes.
But Father, tonight the adversary, the lion that is walking to and fro, sometimes reminds us of sin. But Father, we're thankful, Lord, that our mind still wanders back to Calvary and know that it's covered under the blood. We thank you, Lord, tonight for the messenger. We thank you, Lord, tonight for Brother Tony, Lord, that has brought the word to us and stirred it in our minds and stirred it in our hearts and
yes.
stirred in our spirit, Lord, tonight. And Father, as we have received, Lord, by the Spirit of the Lord, may we go forth now from this place and go and, Lord, and tell the lost and dying world that they need to be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Thank you, Lord, tonight. Be with us again tomorrow night and throughout the week, and steer our community, steer our nation, Lord, with that precious Spirit, Lord, we pray. And Father God, we love you tonight. Thank you for loving us. And
yes.
Thank you for your long suffering and
yes.
enabling us, Lord, tonight to feel the preciousness of thee, Father, tonight. Father, we thank you, Lord, tonight for your goodness and your mercy tonight.
Yes.
And Father, Lord, as we close the service tonight, we'll remember together the prayer of faith, Lord, that you taught us to pray, that says, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen and amen. Praise the Lamb of God.